Greetings to you, my brothers and sisters in Christ. My name is Mangaliso Magudulela. Today we are continuing with our Eucharist series. This is our fifth video of the series and the last one. Of course, this doesn't mean that there's nothing more to speak about on the Eucharist, but at least we have covered what is important about the Eucharist, which enables us to take the Eucharist serious. Now, after watching this video, I would like you to share it with your friends and family and church and everyone that you think should be in a position to listen and watch this video. Today, we are speaking about, as I've mentioned, the Eucharist as a sacrifice according to the Anglican tradition. Eucharist as a sacrifice according to the Anglican tradition. Now, the Christian church has always considered the Eucharist, the Holy Eucharist, as being in a certain manner a sacrifice. This is found in the early Christian church writings outside the New Testament canon. The Didache of the Apostles, which most scholars, by the way, today, they date it to the first century. They say that it was written in the first century. Now, the Didache of the Apostles refer to the Eucharist as a sacrifice when it is urging the Christians to prepare themselves by confession of sins so that their sacrifice may be pure. To quote it directly, I think it deserves to be quoted directly. To quote it directly, it says, sorry, technology, you know, has its own way of freezing and all that. The Didache of the Apostles says in paragraph 14, when speaking about Sunday worship, says, assemble on the Lord's day and break bread and offer the Eucharist. But first make confession of your faults so that your sacrifice may be pure, That's what it says. Assemble on the Lord's day and break bread and offer the Eucharist, but first make confession on your faults so that your sacrifice may be a pure one. That's what it says on the Didache of the Apostles, which was written on the first century, most likely by the apostles themselves. This means that the sacrificial view of the Eucharist can be traced back to the undivided church as early as the Apostolic Age. Apostolic Age meaning that during the time of the apostles. So there is no insistence that the Eucharist as a sacrifice is clearly articulated in the pages of our New Testament, but it is just as so as any great doctrines of the Christian faith. Remember that there we've got doctrines of our Christian faith, but most of them, or some of them, or some of the great doctrines we have, they don't find their basis on the New Testament or clear basis of the New Testament. So what can be concluded about the Eucharist as a sacrifice is that Jesus' words and actions at the Last Supper left an indelible mark in the minds of the apostles and the disciples of Jesus, that of the Eucharist as a sacrificial rite. It is for this reason that through the Didache of the Apostles, they teach us that the Eucharist is a sacrifice. We find that firstly in the Didache of the Apostles. Now, the fact is, from the onset of Christianity, apostles regarded their whole life, prayers, thanksgiving, and self-dedication and service as a sacrifice which reaches its climax at the Eucharist. The offering of Christ in the Eucharist is closely linked with the sacrifice which happened in Calvary. It is in the Eucharist that the sacrifice of Calvary is in a real way brought before God. And also the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, because the same Christ that died is the same Christ that rose from the dead. This sacrifice is seen to be united with the sacrifice in heaven, which sins in heaven, since he who is priest and victim in heaven is priest and victim on the sacrifice on earth. The truth is that, brethren, the Holy Eucharist is a sacrifice because the bread and wine offered at the altar become mysteriously Christ's body and blood, when offered, we offer Christ himself. That makes it a sacrifice. Now, in our Anglican tradition, we see that the Anglican tradition presents a moderate, realistic view of the Eucharistic sacrifice. The Anglican tradition argues that the sacrifice of Christ is presented, pleaded, and offered in a real way in the Eucharist, using the signs of bread and wine as they are offered to God, but excludes the view that the Eucharistic sacrifice is offered in a bloody manner, or that Christ's sacrifice, is reanimated or added in the Eucharist. The fact is, there are two kinds of sacrifice in the Old Testament that we read about. The first one is that there is a bloody sacrifice involving the slaughter of bulls, of goats, and sheep. And the second type of sacrifice that we see in the Old Testament is the unbloody sacrifice. The unbloody sacrifice, which often consisted of bread and wine. There are also two kinds of sacrifices that you see in the New Testament or Second Testament. The first one is the blood sacrifice, or the bloody sacrifice of Christ on the cross. And then the second one being the unbloody sacrifice of bread and wine instituted by Christ himself on the Last Supper, to be done or at all times in memory of his Calvary sacrifice. This then should be the premise for the doctrine of the Eucharist sacrifice. And it is the premise how the apostles viewed the Eucharist being a sacrifice, because they took it that Christ had enacted a new sacrifice which did not involve blood, and that is being of bread and wine. Now, Christ's sacrifice cannot be repeated or added in the Eucharist, but it is offered, and the eternal sacrifice of Christ is connected with the earthly Eucharistic sacrifice in a realistic manner. It is a sacrifice that is not about the destruction of life, as it is bloodless, but it is about dedication of life. That's what Christ's sacrifice at the Eucharist is about. It is an earthly Eucharistic sacrifice that is linked to the heavenly sacrifice, where the eternal sacrifice of Christ has a perpetual application in the Eucharist. Now, Brian Douglas, an Anglican priest and theologian in Australia, specializing in Anglican Eucharistic theology, says that it is in the Eucharist that the Church repetitively recalls and enters into the sacrifice of Christ for all time. This sacrifice re-energizes the Church in the one true sacrifice of Christ that looks forward to the second coming of Jesus Christ. So the Eucharistic sacrifice, Bazalwane, is something that is done by Christ in us, just as the sacrifice he did for us in Calvary, without being re-sacrificed. The late Father Eric Maskell, who was a member of the OGS, Order of Good Shepherd, said that through that sacrifice and death, or rather said that sacrifice and death are not one and the same thing. Sacrifice does not mean the destruction of the victim, as the sacrifice of Christ involves incarnation, suffering, death, resurrection, and ascension. So since the sacrifice of Christ is basically not just about death, it means then the sacrifice involves incarnation, suffering, and death, resurrection, and ascension. So Father Maskell says that actually to sacrifice doesn't mean that you are killing. As he says that sacrifice and death are not one and the same thing. The spiritual sacrifice referred to in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, includes our acts of worship, especially in the Eucharist, but not confined to it. This is something that the early church writers mostly referred to. Now, the Anglican tradition, especially that held by the Anglo-Catholics, affirm the Eucharistic sacrifice without affirming the Eucharistic sacrifice happening in a bloody manner or added to the Eucharist as that cannot be done. It is more than a recall of a sacrifice of Christ on the cross, but about dedication of life, a sacramental sacrifice. That's what we find in the Anglican Church. We view that there is that the Eucharist is a sacrifice, but it doesn't happen in a bloody manner. And it is more than recalling what happened in Calvary. It is more about the dedication of life, a sacramental sacrifice. Now, good people, the Anglican Church presents a moderate, realistic view of the Eucharist sacrifice, which links the Eucharist with Christ's sacrifice at the Last Supper and on the cross. It is first a Eucharistic sacrifice theology held by the Apostolic Church, that being the church during the Apostles' times, and secondly, a Eucharistic sacrifice theology held by the entire early church. You must see that the Anglican Church, when it discusses matters of baptism, matters of the Eucharist, it actually links them with the early church and also the Apostolic Church. So when we speak or when we participate in the Eucharist, we are participating in a sacrifice that offers bread and wine to be transformed by God in order that they become Christ's body and blood. We participate in a sacrifice that offers to keep the memory of Christ intact. It offers to keep the memory of Christ's memory of his suffering, crucifixion, death, and resurrection. We are participating in a sacrifice that offers oneself to be changed by the worship, by penitence, God's word that is read, and most importantly, in receiving Christ's body and blood in order to be changed by Christ's transmitted life into us. As Richard Hooker once said, that the Eucharist ensures a kind of transubstantiation in us. It ensures some kind of change in us. And as George Herbert, another great Anglican, would argue that Christ died for humanity, not for the bread, because it is humanity that needs changing. It is humanity that needs changing. So, fellow Christians in Christ, fellow Anglicans, may you continue to view the Eucharist in a special way, in something beyond our understanding. The Eucharist gives us life. The Eucharist needs to be worshipped. The Eucharist is a sacrifice. The Eucharist is a real presence of God or of Christ. So when we view the Eucharist in that way, we are able to receive Christ and accept the change that comes with receiving the body and blood of Christ. May you through this series be encouraged to respect the Eucharist, just as God respected and loved us by becoming incarnate in order to die and rise for us. Let us pray a prayer that we normally say just at the conclusion right of the Mass, and it's on page 129, at least on the English prayer book, English Anglican prayer book. Let us pray. Father Almighty, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice. In Jesus Christ, our Lord, send us out into the world in the power of the Holy Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Thank you, thank you, thank you very much. Continue to share the videos, and our next series will be on Mary, the Mother of God. The next series will be on Mary, the Mother of God. Thank you very much. Take care of yourself.